Hi, this is Ken Broadway from the University of Florida. I want to talk to you today about vibraphone technique. First of all, a few comments about the mallets we're going to use. We want to use a mallet specifically designed for the vibraphone. Right now I have a marimba mallet in my hand. It has a birch shaft and a yarn head. We want to make sure that the vibraphone mallet has a material called cord. It's a tightly wound material and a rattan shaft. You're going to see these mallets are a good bit shorter in general. And again, this flexibility will be very important for our technique. The other thing I want to talk about with technique is it's not the same as marimba. Even though for young students, we try to make mallet percussion very consistent from instrument to instrument, on the vibraphone, you want to use a slightly different technique. You want to stay low to the instrument. If I were playing on the marimba, I might think about this piston stroke where my mallets are coming up a great deal. On the vibraphone, I want to stay a little bit lower to the instrument. There are a couple of reasons for this. Number one, we want to stay low to the instrument to try to get more articulation. Again, we don't want to use... So a little bit lower to the instrument because we want to hear that articulation. And second, we're going to be using a lot of mallet dampening on vibraphone as we get to advanced techniques, so we want to keep these mallets low. So again, if I'm playing a scale on marimba, I might come up off the bars, or this piston stroke on vibraphone, maybe a little bit more of the front hand fulcrum. So when you play with a little bit more of that velocity. Now it may look tense, but I'm not squeezing the sticks tightly. I'm still controlling the sticks with a firm but relaxed stroke. So you never want to squeeze the sticks tightly. That's just going to cause tension. It's going to slow you down. The second thing we have to deal with is the pedal, and I wish I had a second camera so you could see this, but the pedal is used certainly to stop the sound in between chords. We want to make sure that we're not pedaling with the foot hitting the ground. I'm going to stomp the ground a little bit here. We never want that foot to hit the ground that way. Now you might be tempted to put foam underneath or towels or things like that, but if you have a stage that has a hollow surface underneath it, you're still going to hear that thud. So what I want to try to do is make sure the pedal never hits the ground. So try to make sure your foot doesn't cover the pedal with more than half your foot. I tend to just put my toe over the edge of the pedal, and that way I can move the pedal without hitting the ground. The other thing about this is I want to make sure when my hands are playing forte, my foot is only moving the pedal about this far. So that way I won't have the pedal moving too much. It won't cause a lot of frame noise as well. So playing your scales is very, very important when we're playing vibraphone. The next element we need to deal with as we talk about the pedaling is when should we pedal? Now many times we'll pedal every measure. You know, for example, a phrase might be 4 beats long or 8 beats long, but sometimes we have to pedal as chords change. So I start out working on my scales and setting up pedaling exercises. So I first might pedal a scale. I'm gonna go up to the 9th scale degree. I'm in F major, so that means I'm gonna play from F all the way up to G, and then back down. So first I'm just gonna hold the pedal down. That builds up a lot of sound. We've gotta get some of that sound out of the way. So now I'm gonna pedal every 8 notes. And sometimes I will pedal what we call half pedaling, where the pedal is moving very little and it barely leaves contact with the felt on the bar. So these are all things we do with scales before we even work on the music. And again, we're talking about just two mallets at this point. When we get into 4-mallet playing, we still will use the same techniques we would use for playing the instrument with our pedal, for sure. So get comfortable with the pedaling, get comfortable with the basic technique. And then as you get into 4 mallets, you'll have to decide, are you going to play with what we call often the Stevens, Musser-Stevens technique, or what many of us play, is the cross grip, often called the Burton technique. I personally like playing with this cross grip on vibraphone for a number of reasons. Number one, it separates my marimba technique from my vibraphone technique. So when I play Stevens, I tend to play more of a piston type stroke on the marimba. When I play vibraphone, it gets me more into that vibraphone technique. The other thing is, many times in vibe solos and vibe playing, we tend to play with the outside mallet being our melodic voice. So when I'm playing with this cross grip, it really does put the strength in that outside mallet very, very specifically, so I can really play those melodies. And then finally, many of the pieces written are, again, designed around this technique. It doesn't mean we have to. There are great vibists who play with so-called Stevens grip. There are great marimbas who play with cross grip. So it's not a marimba grip and a vibe grip, but I just wanted to explain why I tend to use the cross grip more on vibraphone to separate that. So many times, one of the first things I do with my students is play progressions. You know, simplest one we would use is something like this in C major. So we're playing a one chord. We're playing a four chord in second inversion. Playing a 5-7 chord in second inversion, and then a 1 chord again. In theory, that would be a 1-4-6-4-5-4-3-1, and those are the intervals above the bass. So I want to make sure I can get comfortable with that. Whatever grip I'm using, I want to make sure I can do that in every key, every major key, every minor key. So then I'm getting my progressions down. And finally, we need to work on mallet dampening. So some of the exercises we work on here, the idea is that we want to keep the pedal down and we want to move the other mallet over the note we just played and dampen it at the same time we are playing the next note. A typical way we would do this is playing a major scale. It's important to keep the mallets low. You want to make sure that you are staying very close to the instrument. So you don't get any excess noise. So this is playing a scale, and certainly going back to F major. You'd be able to move to certainly what we call the black notes on the instrument as well. So that's the first mallet dampening exercise I work on, just playing up and down scales. And certainly if you know your green scale, you can play this, and change direction. Etc. Just getting used to going from right to left to right to left. The next exercise I like to use for working on mallet dampening is a scale in broken thirds. So as I play the C, I have to get ready to dampen that note, because when I play the E, I'm going to dampen the C. And on the way down, same thing. This is a very important exercise to work on, because many times that change of direction gets us in trouble, and it sounds something like this. Start getting a flam sound. So here's where playing low to the instrument is so, so important. You can see where if I came up on that piston stroke after every stroke, I'm not prepared for that mallet dampen. So it's very important to keep our mallets low and keep that energy towards the bars themselves. And finally, there's one other type of mallet dampening we use. It's what we call a slide dampen among the many. So here, a good example of how we might use this, is if I'm playing that progression I performed a moment ago. So I played a 4-3 suspension. So in this case, I wanted that 4 dissonance to be there and then resolve to the 3. But if I have to pedal those notes, it takes away that sense of dissonance and resolution. So as I play this, what I end up doing, start again. So that's that's how I would dampen it with just my mallet dampening. But I can also slide as I play one note and dampen the next. So here's choice A, where I might do it with our typical mallet dampening. Sorry. Now I'm going to slide dampen. This is very important when I have my hands far apart. So a great exercise to work on here is to play a scale. I usually use my outside mallet. I can certainly use the inside mallet, but it's very common that this is our melody voice. So once again, think about that green scale. A little passage, kind of unprepared, that utilizes a lot of these techniques. It's a small snippet of a piece by Arthur Lippner called Foreign Intrigue. So we start from the beginning. My melody's in my right hand. And I want to bring that voice out. Melody goes upward. Voice's hands low to the keyboard. I try to bring out that higher note, but still give it articulation. But that slide dampen keeps me from having to reach up with my right hand. I certainly can play that passage. Both ways. And again, these are very simple things, but they're things that have to be worked on that are very different, very unique to this instrument from all the other instruments we play in the keyboard percussion world. Again, a few reminders. Make sure you have the appropriate mallet, rattan shaft, cord, wrapped mallet, that's C-O-R-D, and it usually has this mushroom shape. This is very helpful for playing the articulations and for doing our mallet dampening. The rattan shaft is very important for being able to do our mallet dampening as well. We want to make sure we get comfortable with the pedal, playing scales, and certainly playing chord progressions. A really common chord progression, again, is just the 1-4-6-4, 5-4-3 to the 1. And we want to work on all these passages to make sure we can play music well. And finally, our mallet dampening exercises, we'll play scales, we'll play broken thirds, and then we'll play our slide dampen as well. Hope these tips have helped you out. Please contact me at kbroadway@arts.ufl.edu if you have any questions. Thanks for watching.